If it is taken as income, then you should provide for it straight away. Some of the banks have got that method of doing it. Then takeout finance. Takeout finance is transfer of, that is one institution will be dealing with the whole loan, and after the project is stabilized or completed, the loan will be transferred to the respective member banks. So at the time of transfer, if the status is NPA, then that NPA status also will go along with the loan to the other bank. Until then, this bank will treat it as NPA in these books. But when it gets transferred, the member bank which takes over the loan will treat it as NPA from the, I mean, the classification will pertain to the original date of classification of NPA in the hands of the lead bank. So that you should be careful. So whenever there is an advance under rehabilitation scheme, under BFR or term lending institution, their permission has got to be obtained and the package is worked out. See, unless it should not be upgraded, the package is working out for 1 year satisfactorily. For additional facilities for such cases, we should treat it as standard for a period of 1 year. If that standard account becomes bad, then automatically it will go along with the original loan. The additional facilities will get clubbed with the original loan. Then one should look for interest suspense account. If there is an interest suspense account, the related account has got to be reduced from that, and then only provision has got to be made, because it's a contra-entry again. Some of them maintain in shadow account, which will not form part of the balance sheet. But by creating interest suspense account, it will form part of the balance sheet. ECGC has got to be taken care of after deducting the security, and provision has got to be made. Similarly, this credit guarantee scheme for medium and small enterprises and low income housing, that has got to be taken care of, that is, that need not be provided for, in other words. Then another very important aspect is that provisioning for diminution in fair value of restructured advances. Whenever there is a reschedulement, there is a sacrifice on the part of the bank. There is an economic loss in terms of cash flow, which will affect the equity rating or equity value of the bank itself. As a result, diminution of fair value in lieu of the loss has got to be provided for. It is very, very important actually, both in respect of standard as well as NPAs. This provisioning has got to be netted from the related asset. But the total provisioning should not exceed 100%. See, this provisioning, one may ask the question, we are already providing for NPA. Where is the question of another provision now? The provision for NPA is for the deterioration in the quality of the recoverability of the asset or the advance. Whereas here, this is only the loss incurred by the bank due to concession given on account of reschedulement. So this is totally a different loss. The cash flow is not going to come when you defer the repayment period, or when you reduce the interest, or when you reduce the principal. Naturally, your cash flows are affected. As a result, your returns are affected. So to compensate that, you will have to provide for that. So this is very, very important, and the formula applied for that is based on the base rate, the tenor premium, the credit risk premium, and you will compare it with the cash flows, what was before reschedulement and what is after reschedulement. Then the difference has got to be taken into account and provided for. If it is difficult, then the RBI has suggested, the circular, the master circular has suggested, you provide 5% of the loans outstanding for this aspect, namely diminution in fair value for loans up to 1 crore. So that the bank, because banks may, see, banks are applying different types of calculations to suit their needs. So that RBI has warned, in fact, in the circular, in the master circular, saying that you have to follow a very reasonable and very acceptable and approach, and you should not do financial engineering with this, because it is a provision item. It should not be subjective. So it should be calculated properly. So proper system should be in place in the branch. This is restructuring flow chart I have given. See, I have given the how repeated restructuring means. Yes means NPA downgraded. It is all original terms means here I must do a correction. It is as per extant guidelines. Wherever original terms it comes, extant guideline, it may not be there. It may not be there. Yes, I have added only just now in the afternoon. Maybe you can get a copy from Mr. Ram Kumar. So how satisfactory performance will result in upgraded asset. So this I have illustrated with different possibilities. So the concept of restructuring, as I was talking about DCCO particularly, now it is going to be taking pride of place because of the fact we all know there is a slowdown in the industrial arena. During this year, particular this year, there has been a lot of slowdown. Industries have not been doing well at all. So banks are bound to resort to restructuring. And there have been changes in the master circular regarding restructuring. So I want to highlight certain of the aspects. This started in 2008-09. Restructuring, the famous August circular 2008, it all started from there, where special regulatory treatment was given to treat the account as standard. Lot of accounts have been, that time also it was a slowdown, so lot of accounts were upgraded and lot of accounts were restructured. As a result, bank could withstand the cyclical fluctuations. This year, it may so happen that banks may resort to more restructuring. So restructured account due to economic or legal reasons relating to the borrower's difficulty, it is where it is considered, and modifications of terms of loans of the advances, securities, alteration of payment, all this I have defined. I must rush through this, but I have given in detail whatever it is. Another 10 minutes more. So repeatedly restructured account, that is very, very important. One has to look for whether, whenever we look into a restructured account, we should look for the fact whether it is repeatedly restructured. When was the last restructuring done? Whether there is satisfactory performance during the specific period. Thereafter, if it is restructured, it doesn't matter. So it can be done for all types of accounts, whether it is standard, substandard, except for the loss asset. Loss asset cannot be restructured for reasons well known to us. And willful defaulters also, we require the approval of the board. That is the branch, the bank branch has got to get the approval of the board. And as far as CDR is concerned, it is a core group. And lead bank in the case of SME debt restructuring. Then it cannot be done with retrospective effect. And normally, NPAs would continue to have the same asset classification upon restructuring and slip into further lower asset, that is the downgradation as per extant norms with respect to pre-structuring repayment schedule. That is very important. That is original repayment schedule, if it gets back. So when an account is under consideration for restructure, nothing can be done. It should go as per the extant norms only. Only when the sanction is there, you will have to take into account the restructuring. That is very important. So the branch manager may say, no, it is at the verge of getting over, getting finished. So please don't treat it as substandard or whatever it is. No, it should be over. It should be sanctioned by the appropriate authority. Then only we can take it as restructured. That's very important, actually. Then assessment of financial viability, as I told you, the parameters like return on capital employed, DSCR, then internal rate of return, the gap between internal rate of return and cost of funds, all these have got to be considered very carefully, and viability has got to be established before taking up restructuring. Satisfactory performance in the case of agricultural advances. At the end of the specified period, the account should be regular. If it is regular, then it is satisfactory performance in the case of agricultural advances. In the case of non-agricultural advances, there is a difference. That is, there should not be any overdues. There is no overdues for a period more than 90 days during the specified period. That is one aspect. And no overdues at the end of the specified period. If both the conditions, it is cumulative, if the both the conditions are complied with, then only you can upgrade it in the case of non-agricultural advances. That's very, very important. Whereas in the case of agricultural advances, only at the end of the period, that is specified period, it should be regular. I have elaborated on this diminution in the fair value. Then the exempted categories are, that is, which do not come under special regulatory treatment: consumer personal loans, capital market exposures, commercial real estate exposures. This is very important because most of the branch managers are under the impression this is applicable for these loans also. They restructure it and argue with us also many times. So that we should be very careful not to do this. Then incentive is given if it is decided within 120 days, the application. Then the conditions are there. That is, standard asset remains standard and no further deterioration on the following conditions. One is, dues are fully secured. Whenever they come for restructuring as a standard asset, it will be retained as standard under special regulatory treatment. But the fact is, here, fully secured, normally we don't go into the guarantees. Here, BG, that is bank guarantee, state government guarantee, central government guarantee, can be taken as tangible securities. Remember, while considering the NPA secured portion, we don't consider the guarantees. But in the case of special regulatory treatment, we consider these guarantees as secured. So it should be fully secured, and viability is achieved in 8 years and 5 years. These have all been amended, actually. Previously it was different during this master circular thing. And MSME 25 lakhs, and repayment period also 15 years and 10 years in the case of infrastructure and non-infrastructure. And promoter sacrifice also has been amended, where he has to give it, that is, minimum of 20% bank sacrifice or 2% of the restructured debt has got to be brought in as promoter sacrifice, and it should be brought in 100% upfront. That is very important. And conversion of unsecured loans into equity is treated as promoter's contribution, and derating of equity also is considered as promoter's contribution. Derating of equity is nothing but reducing the value of equity. Say, from, suppose there is an equity of 10 crore, they will consider it as only as 8 crore. And the viability will be worked on that basis. So derating may take place. That is also considered as promoter's contribution towards the bank sacrifice. It is not a repeated restructuring. And the provisions are similar to what I told you about, this 5% that I have repeated here. Then CDR accounts, of course, I have not touched upon much because it's another chapter by itself. Thank you for your patient listening. I hope within the time allowed to me, I think I could explain the salient features of restructuring and NPA norms. Thank you for the opportunity once again to SIRs.
Few quick questions.
Loan is considered as a non-performing loan after 90 days if it is interest or principal due is not coming. For considering the age of the NPA, that is more than 1 year old or 2 year old, whether this 90 days also should be taken into account or from the expiry of 90 days the age is to be counted?
90 days should be taken into account.
Do you know?
So 90 days should be taken into account.
From that 90th day onwards or from inception, from the first day?
First day.
Okay. And financial asset reconstruction company, and the consideration is not immediately coming. The consideration is in the form of a 0% bond to be paid over a period of 5 years. In that case, what will be the status of those NPAs which have been sold?
In that also, every month or every quarter, some amount will be paid.
That is 0% bond, payable after 50 years.
Normally in the agreement, there will be some regular payment also. So if that regular payment is not coming through 90 days, then it will be treated as NPA in that recent instance.
Okay.
Otherwise, if it is due only, it is only the due date that has got to be taken into account. So agreement, according to the agreement, if it has got to be paid after 5 years, then it has got to be paid after 5 years only. It falls due only on that date.
Okay. Meanwhile, the statute
says, it says due date. So what is the due date as per agreement? That has got to be found out.
One thing, since there's a question on the account or the loan account becoming NPA for the first time, since I'm seeing some of the very young members who may be doing the bank audit first time, when an advanced account becomes an NPA for the first time, the interest, all interest debited during the current year and also the previous year will have to be reversed. Probably that was discussed in the morning session. I was not there for Mr. Mani's session. So that is something which disturbed the branch managers because it will hit the profitability immediately. Current year, whatever has been debited as well as the previous year, that has to be taken care of.
Previous year has got to be provided for. The current year has got to be reversed.
So it will have an impact on the P&L right away. Yeah, fine. Yeah. So once again, suggesting that we read the guidance note on bank audit in addition to what the insights have been provided by the speakers. Bank audit seminars, which is there on the website, and also the master circular, which the speaker times. So this is something which is a basic document which we can rely on, and of course the head office circulars which have been sent to the branches. So I take this opportunity to thank Mr. Swaminathan. He was denied his normal time because we have to hand over this particular hall to the hotel back at 5:15. So I was in a bit of a hurry. I should apologize for that. I would now request Mr. G.R. Ravi to come forward and give a memento to learned speaker from Pondicherry, Mr. Swaminathan. Thank you very much for staying till the very end. And this time SIRC will have a lot of programs for the members. 27th and 28th of this month, we are having the orientation for the branch chairman and secretaries in Kodaikanal. So that is where the annual action plan would really roll out. We expect your continued support. I am requesting this on behalf of the SIRC chairman, Mr. Rajarajan. Continued support and participation in all the activities. And as a SIRC chairman this year, the SIRC will have a lot of programs. All the major places, Hyderabad, Bangalore, Cochin, Coimbatore, everywhere we are having major programs. I request you all out of support by sending your students. and for all the SICASA programs, we assure value addition to them. And tomorrow we have the SICASA seminar on bank audit, and some of the members who still feel that there's little more to be learned, you are also welcome for tomorrow's seminar. I did not mention, I think the pamphlet has been distributed. The registration fee is 200, including the background material and the lunch. On that note, I thank you all once again for staying through the whole day and for actively taking part in the deliberations. Thank you very much and have a good evening.